You're listening to the Rock and Roll Revival with Chuck Stevens. Has all of your favorites from the 50s, 60s, and 70s. Good times and great oldies with Chuck Stevens.
Okay, it's Chuck Stevens here on the Rock and Roll Revival, and we have a very special guest with us on this show, very well known for Hushabye and Darling Don't Cry. I'd like to welcome in George Galfo of the Mystics. Welcome to the show, George.
Thanks, Chuck. It's a pleasure to be here, and it's Darling I Know Now.
And I understand the whole thing started, what, back in 1956?
Well, we got together on Street Corners in 1956. Yeah, we just singing around and trying different songs, singing, even writing a few at the time. We had some originals that we wrote. But actually, we didn't get to Lori Records until 1959. That's when we recorded.
Now, was there any musical influence in the family at all, or were you just the only singer?
Well, my brother and I used to sing, we used to fool around before I got with the guys on the Mystics. And we used to do a couple of things local, but nothing like, you know, nothing important. Just kidding around with it, with a little three-piece band behind us and just fooling around. So, but the serious part came when I got together with the guys on the Mystics. And two of them, I'm sure you know, are my uncles.
Mm-hmm.
And you Phil and then Albie Krakalisi. They were my mother's brothers, and they were all about the same age, so we hung out together.
And you also had another name besides the Mystics that came before that. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
What, the Overons?
The Overons, yeah.
Well, that didn't go up too big with Lori Records. They didn't think it was a marketable name, so they wanted us to pick something else. So we all put a couple of names in a hat, and one of the guys picked it out, and the one that came up was the Mystics, and it stuck with us ever since.
Guess what? You did the same thing as Larry Chance and the Earls did. You probably
really? I didn't know that.
Yep, that's the same exact story.
Wow, that's cool.
Tell us a little bit about Gene Schwartz of Lori Records and how he introduced you to the label and what he thought about the group and, you know, so on and so forth.
Well, when we got up there and we tried out, we gave him a couple of our demos that we had recorded. They liked the sound right away. So the first thing they did was contact a couple of their writers, their authors that they use a lot, which was Doc Pomus and Mort Schumann, to go out and give these guys and get a song for them. And that's what they did. But let me tell you, the first song that came back that they wrote for us was Teenager in Love. And we liked it, and we started to fool around with it. But Dion was there and heard us rehearsing it and said, gee, I like that song. And he said, could I think the Belmonts and myself could do a great job on it. And they did. And we gave it to him because he had first choice. He was at Lori first anyway. So he had more pull. So we said, no problem, Dion. You can have it. So they went out, and 5 days later, they came back with Hushabye.
Now, looking back at the group, how many of the original group members are still with the Mystics, and how many have moved on? I noticed there were quite a few different members who moved on. There was Paul Simon in there and a few others.
Right. Well, thank God the five originals are still around. Most of them, they're retired. Phil and I, my Uncle Phil and I, are still carrying on. And we're two of the original that go around and perform.
Now, did you ever have any affiliations with the Dick Clark Caravan of Stars or his particular show or ever appear in the show?
Sure, we did Dick Clark show twice. We did it with Hushabye and we did it with Don't Take the Stars.
What was that like for you psychologically, being an entertainer and being on the Dick Clark show and going to concerts and stuff like that? How did that affect you psychologically?
Well, it did affect us, I'm sure it did, just being there in awe. We were still in shock after getting the first hit. We was lucky to have that. And everything was happening so quick and so fast. We didn't realize that, who we were and where we were. And, none of us had egos, so we just took it as it was. And we were very happy to be there. And at the beginning, we were there at the beginning, and it's still carrying on till today, 55 years later.
That's incredible, isn't it?
Yeah. In fact, we got, it's the...
55th anniversary.
Oh, 56th anniversary this year of Hushabye, so it's a long time.
You have another mind there, right?
Right. Yeah.
What about Eddie Schatz of the Falcons?
Well, he sang one of the songs with us. He was there hanging around with Jim Gribble, knew him, and he brought us up because we needed to get some songs out for Lori. We had a contract to fulfill, and Phil, my uncle, wasn't available at the time because he was in service, and there's a couple of things that he was doing personally. So we needed some help to get the songs out, and that's where Paul Simon came in and did a few cuts with us. And, in fact, he was a very talented kid, and we had a lot of fun with him. Then we had Jay Traynor also, who came in and sang a couple of cuts with us. And they went on to do bigger and better things by themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And Eddie came in, and he did Goodbye, Mr. Blues for us.
Actually, I said the Falcons, but I should have said Eddie Schatz Falcone.
Yeah. Oh,
there we go.
Yeah.
If you look back, which group or groups most influenced the Mystics, or you yourself?
Well, at the time, my favorites were, we were listening to the radio all the time, and the Crests and the Skyliners, even the Flamingos. I mean, they were my favorites at the time, and we enjoyed listening to them, and even the Elegants when they came out with The Little Star, we used to sing all those songs on the corners and try and mimic them until we got where we were. We got heard, and we were lucky. It was just a matter of timing, being in the right place at the right time.
Exactly. Now, did you get a chance to meet all of these people? I mean, you mentioned several groups, the Elegants, the Flamingos, and so on. I mean, did you meet a lot of great doo-wop groups back then, singing on the corner?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Well, we do a lot of shows with them now.
Now, was that...
We still do shows with the Skyliners. We see Vito all the time on the shows, from the Elegants.
Uh-huh.
The Flamingos. We do shows with all of them today, and we have more fun today, and we appreciate where we are more than when we did then, in the early days.
Oh, that's great. Now,
it's terrific to get together and go over some old things that happened to us in the past and talk about the shows and the people we've met, and it's really a nice thing. We get together backstage and we even sing together.
What was it like when the British invasion hit the United States? A lot of people speak of that, and they say it kind of took over and it interfered with their particular style of singing. Did it have anything?
Well, it did for a while. You mean when the Beatles came in, they were all self-contained, you know, with their own musical instruments, which was just great. I mean, it was a good, clean change for the music, but it put aside the just the vocal groups for a while, and, you know, that was the change that it made. But listen, what goes around comes around. There's a lot of vocal groups coming back now. Four or five guys getting together and singing without instruments. I see more of that every day.
Well, I saw the dubs, I saw the harp tones, and the flamingos, and they all sounded great. They sounded as good as they sounded back then, even better.
Oh, yeah, it's amazing. Some of us, they, you know, we still sound as if Charlie Thomas of the Drifters. I can't get over that guy. He sounds terrific every time I hear him.
If you had to look back, what would you say was the most inspiring moment in your lifetime as a performer?
I think when we did, the Fox Theater. In Brooklyn, you know, we were there for 10 days, and it was such a dynamic, multi-act show. That was one of the greatest times I've had on stage, because that was, you know, we were still new to the industry, and still got the butterflies when I took that stage, I'll tell you.
Well, I think a lot of the entertainers still have butterflies before they go out on stage.
Yeah, it's just the until you get on stage, you know. As soon as you open your mouth and the first words come out, then you just flow right into it, and the butterflies are gone.
That's what I had heard.
It's just the anticipation of getting out there and facing the crowd.
I was reading a story, and this is not uncommon, obviously, but you guys were... overcome by this agent who came along and offered you $1,000 for to make a cut a song in a recording studio.
Way back. Yeah, that was before Jim Gribble. This guy offered us to do things for us as long as we gave him some money up front so he can get things started and, you know, demos and productions. And it was a scam. You know, he tried to do a couple of things, but he was green, but he took advantage of us. But we soon found out, and being Brooklyn boys as we are, we just told him where he had to go, and you know, nicely, diplomatically, but he got the hint, and we went out on our own until we met Jim Gribble.
And it's amazing too. They say this guy was a successful lawyer and talent agent, and look what happened. Now, this is the second time I've heard of a story such as this.
You know, you never know. There was a lot of stuff going on out there that if you weren't aware of it, they took advantage of it.
Now, most of the street corner symphonies, did they occur in Philly or in Brooklyn or both?
Oh, both. There was a lot of good groups in Philly, and there's many groups in New York, actually, but both of them, I guess Pittsburgh, too, has quite a few, especially with the Skyliners.
I always ask the same question. What is it about Philly that there's so many great entertainers came out of Philly?
I don't know. It must have been in the air.
It must have been
like I say, it's all timing. And who's there available that can help you get that first step into it, you know?
Because
if you have the right people, the right leading, it happens to a lot, you know, it happens a lot sooner to a lot of people.
Larry Chance thought it was in the water, he said.
In the water?
In the water, yeah, just jokingly.
Yeah, he's a great guy, you know. I enjoy talking to him. Larry's a funny guy.
Yeah. What are the plans for the Mystics now? I know you're doing a lot of concerts, and you're doing some, looks like you're going on some ship tours and all that, and a lot of things happening for the Mystics.
Sure, we're still in it. We have a lot of things coming up. We still travel a lot, depending on where the contracts come in from, and we get out there and do what we have to do, and we love bringing the memories back to the people. They just love hearing the old songs, and you look at their faces from the stage and how much they're enjoying it.
Now, when you look back to the song Hushabye, tell the fans what Hushabye is all about.
Well, it was a lullaby that they wanted to do on the same thing as the Elegants, because that was a year before us. And they said that should fit our harmony that they figured could do the best for it. And thank God it went over well.
So the Mystics pretty much consider themselves a good harmonizing group. Like I spoke with Vito Pacone and I spoke with a few others, and they mentioned the fact that their tone or their whole theme was harmonizing, and they mentioned a lot of groups back in the 50s that they were influenced by, and none of them obviously were doo-wop groups, but they were groups that, like the Hilltoppers and the Four Freshmen and so on, and they identified with that group as far as the harmonizing goes.
Absolutely.
Like the Dupreys.
They were well. Look, the harmony they did was very hard to do. It's still hard today for what they did, and it did influence us, and we tried to do it. And you know, that's how we, I guess, got together on the tone that we had, and the harmony just blended in. And I just love the a cappella numbers, so just to hear the harmony.
Are the Mystics in the Hall of Fame? Are they looking? Are they? Have they been inducted into any types of halls of fames? I know there's several different types.
Yeah, we've been. It came close a few times on a request about us being in there, but I don't think it actually happened. Maybe one of these days they will.
Oh, it will come. Don't worry about it.
it's 56 years. I mean, they better decide something quick, no?
Just keep praying. God will answer your question. You'll answer and put you right in that Hall of Fame. What would you like to tell the fans?
Well, I'm glad that we're still doing it today. We have more fun today than we ever did. Like I say, I enjoyed the fans and just watched their faces. And they sing every word with you, you know. They know all the words of all the songs, which is amazing.
It is amazing. What would you like to tell the fans around the world? Because we do stream worldwide through iTunes, and you know, we have quite an audience. So, do you have any last words for the fans around the world?
Oh yeah, absolutely. Well, there's people that get in touch with us almost every day from Spain, from England, from Germany. There's some. I'm sorry, Joni.
Some of them went to Barcelona. They met us.
Oh, yeah. Well, we took a trip recently. It was business and pleasure. And we had a stop off in Spain. And in Barcelona, the people that, they you know, get in touch with us on the website, they met us there. And there was a couple of groups, the Earth Angels, they called them. The
Velvet Candles.
And the Velvet Candles. And there was Doppers. Yeah, they called themselves Doppers or something like that. And they met us when we got off the boat, and they want to see if they want to put a doo-wop show together, and they want to know if I was interested to go back and do it. I said, well, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Just put it together and let us know. But we get a lot of mail from out of the country. Actually, I'm amazed that you know, we were number one in Guam.
In Guam, really?
And in Hawaii, yeah, we were number one in Hawaii too with Hushabye. In fact, most of the states were number one. In New York, I think we only come up to, it was in the tens. I think the eighth or ninth position.
Actually, I shouldn't be too surprised that you said Guam, because when I look at the statistics around the world as far as the our show is concerned, we play 50s, 60s, 70s, and 80s, and a lot of doo-wop. There's a lot of great listeners over in the UK, Europe, China, and there's a lot in Japan.
Yeah, it's amazing that they love our music, and they still do it today. We get these groups that send us all kinds of CDs that they do, and a lot of a cappella groups out there, and they're younger guys. And it's amazing that they still love doo-wop, you know, and I get a kick out of that.
I'm going to let you go in a minute, then I'm going to have you hang on. Any last words for the fans around the world?
Well, just check our website if they want to see what we're doing, and maybe they can catch some of our shows. It's theoriginalmystics.com. They can get, our date schedule, and if we're in their territory or in their area, please come and see us. You'll have a blast.
Any plans on coming to Boston at all?
We got something coming up and let's see, what do we got in the Boston area? We got...
Oh, we have Foxwoods.
That's in Connecticut.
Foxwoods.
We're going to be in Foxwoods in a couple of, in next month, I believe.
August 2nd.
Yeah, August 2nd. She gives me the dates because I forget the dates. I can't remember all the dates.
And New Bedford, August 20th.
Yeah, New Bedford in August
20th.
Okay. 23rd.
Okay.
Yeah, well, we'll be in Detroit. In July. We got a lot of things coming up, and we do a lot of local stuff in Florida, the West Coast and Northern Florida.
And all those concerts will be with, obviously, a caravan of stars or three or four groups.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Multiple acts. And that's when I get to see all the guys again, and we have a really good time.
That's great. George, I'd like to have you, really thank you for being on the show, and it's been a pleasure, and I'm sure the fans are going to enjoy hearing from you, because we're going to run another Facebook doo-wop request show. We did one last week. But I want you to hang on for 1 second.
Hi, this is George Galfo, original member of the Mystics, Hushabye, and you're listening to Chuck Stevens' Rock and Roll Revival, where they play the greatest doo-wop in town.
'59 Solid Gold, the song that made them famous, done by the Mystics. George Galfo and the Mystics, Hushabye, right here on the Rock and Roll Revival. Thanks for checking in with us. Chuck Stevens here, playing 50s, 60s, 70s, and 80s. More of the Mystics. Oh, if you only let me try. done by the Mystics right here on the Rock and Roll Revival. Banging out some of the greatest oldies of all time right here on the Rock and Roll Revival.